Na'vi's turn to back. Na'vi's turn to pick. Enchantress. Dire team pick. Dire team pick.
Lion.
Na'vi's turn to this, turn to that. Dire team back. Remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve.
I preferred TI2 other than you didn't get the dream finals in TI2, but I thought TI2 was a little better, but
I mean, like TI3, obviously they're very similar, but the game, we just brought Alliance on board as a part of the team, sitting up in that box after casting, being
5 seconds
hugging Alex, hugging all of our staff.
Yep.
He's
then me, Alex, and Sean Green just lit out as soon as GG was called. We lit out and ran, sprinted backstage over there to meet loaded guys and hug them whenever they want. Put on.
Reserve time.
Oh my god, it's so hot.
Dieting. I
just want my shorts.
Adrian, you're at your service.
Na'vi's turn to pick.
Lycan.
Dire team pick. Seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time. Seconds remaining.
Hero Copter!
Na'vi's turn to pick. Puck! Dire Team Buck. Remaining. 5 seconds remaining.
Having fun's not much of a problem, my friend. We're having a ton of fun here on the floor. I'm going to quote the philosopher David Parker, perhaps the best game of Dota you'd ever seen in game one. It was one of those games where you just wanted to literally forehead yourself straight onto the deck.
There was a bit of that going on during that last fight. I was sitting there talking, and I'm just like...
No, this is no joke. As I was casting those crazy moments, I kept hearing like these smacking sounds. I look over and it's him every time, this quack. Foreheading himself. But anyway, game two is ready to get going. 3, 2, 1. Na'Vi, 2 games away from claiming this Star Ladder Championship. Whereas VGR, well, they want to make this best of 5 into a best of 3, knot it up to 1 apiece. My friend, give me the rundown. What do you think of the lane so far? Obviously, a little unorthodox look coming out of Na'Vi, to put it lightly.
It's unorthodox, but it's similar to the concept of last game. Have 2 aggressive roaming heroes, both Sinico and Artsile, on 100% roamies. You've got the jungle enchantress, you've got the bounty hunter. Same thing from Artsile, slightly different from Sinico, the bounty instead of the Earth Spirit, but pretty much very close to what the Earth Spirit gives you as far as the ability to pressure mid lane, look for kills, look for pickoffs. So VGR have to protect their lanes. Lone Druid is something that can be exploited in the offlane. The mid lane Windranger has some survivability with Windrun, but Gyrocopter, this is the lane, the Gyro Lion lane. Last game we saw it get rotated on very early on, and I expect similar from Na'Vi here again.
I'll tell you who I would not want to be in this game, that's FY. His job is going to be nigh on impossible with a bounty, ready to roam on him, probably stick to him like glue, the Enchanters as well. See what's going to happen here. Battle for the Rune, it will be the Windranger that gets it, and the Invoker also gets it. So each of the mids taking that is the, as everyone moves into position, let's take a look at who's handling who as the lanes take shape. We'll be Sinico, as mentioned, playing on our Bounty Hunter. The Enchantress going to be handled by Artsile, 2nd game in a row. And we were worried about him last time, but man, did he come through in a big way when they needed it the most. Invoker taken mid by Dendi, one of his iconic heroes, no doubt about it. Dichira going to be farming up the Lycan out of the safe lane and going into the off lane on another Dendi iconic hero, but this time played by the General. He's going to be going up against End, helped out by DDC, who's back on the Lion. End back on the Gyrocopter as well. He's actually going to take a fair amount of damage, but he will be able to make it back to his own Tier 1. Chin, as mentioned, already getting harassed by Sineko. He's played by FY. The Lone Druid going to be played by Yang, going one-on-one up against this Lycan and the Wind Ranger. That's going to be Mikasa doing what he can here in mid.
Yeah, the Mikasa vs. Dendi matchup, we've seen Mikasa struggle a bit, but across the board, it's never seemed to have affected Vici's strategy too much. Even in that last game, it wasn't really the deciding factor by any means, but gotta find a way to deal with these aggressive support roams. And Artsal already smoked up, we're just a minute into the game, very similar to what we saw last game, and he's looking to take control, shut this Chen down from the get-go.
Speaking of shut down,
Sneaker's on him again! This is like, anyway, as a Chen, you're like, okay, there's a bounty, that's a bit tough. Let's try and avoid him, there's enough camps I can stay away.
Now he's gonna run in the two Hell Bears, right at the top, two big claps! First blood! Drawn by Sineko with the help, of course, of the Enchantress and a Sunstrike from Dendi and mid. Navi off to another great start.
Tasa, you don't want to go running into these guys. The only way that goes better is if Dendi actually gets the first blood with right. that Sunstrike. Unfortunately for Navi, they need a little bit more damage afterwards, but they've completely ruined FY's early game, and there's no real easy way back in it for him. And now that you kind of shut down the Chen's first couple of minutes, you can prioritize Mikasa, who still has a long way to go before he has bottle. He only has 4 CS in 2 minutes here, and he's taking a lot of damage.
Mikasa eating a shockwave from that Seder, but will make it back. He has very little mana and very little health. He will be able to get his health back up with the salve, but tough going, man. This Chen has been bouncing back and forth, and he's just still level 1. The Bounty Hunter himself is at least dinged level 2, and Enchantress still level 1, actually. That's a little surprising. I thought Artstyle had spent a little more time jungling, but still level 1 for him. So either way, they're making FY's life hell. Up here at top, Puck's doing okay, actually. He's got 6 CS.
Yep, Puck doing fine. Lycan actually, for now, winning the CS battle against Lone Druid. That's likely to change once the Entangle comes into play in this lane. It gets very difficult for D'Chirap, but winning the CS battle early on, very impressive stuff from him. But
so Nako's gonna hook back up with Artstyle. They're gonna go for a gank here.
Yep.
Let's see.
Oh, no Savage Roar. I don't like this build from Yang. And that could become a big, big problem as Sineko is headed down here and Yang sees this with a Sentry Orb, but without Savage, he just dies. No Shuriken.
Yep, exactly. Okay. Very close damage was there, but no stun, no way to knock him out of the team.
Summer nightmare.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
A prize!
Dire's courier has been killed. Radiant's top tower is under attack.
Shackle! My quiver is empty.
Sorry.
Dire's middle tower is under attack. Radiant's top tower is under attack. Radiant's middle tower is under attack. Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
That madness perishes with me.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack. Radiant's top tower is under attack. Radiant's structures are fortified. Dire's top tower is under attack. Dire's structures are fortified. Dire's top tower is under attack. Radiant's bottom tower is under attack. Dire's top tower has fallen. Radiant's bottom tower has fallen. tower is under attack. Dire's top tower has fallen. Radiant's bottom tower is under attack. Dire's top tower is under attack.
That's just extra gold. It's spread around, and that piles up. I mean, it's not, you know, going to make or break a game, certainly on its own, but you get four or five of those in the first 20 minutes. Suddenly, your supports have a blink dagger before the other supports do, and so on and so on. So, very well played all across the board.
And a lot of farm on Dendi. Is it 2.2k gold? Is this going to be the Dendi blink that he loves to go for? We'll have to wait and see. Yep. He loves this build. The blink, we even see him go blink four stuff. He's probably one of the few invokers who prioritizes blink as an early game pickup over like the Yule Scepter, the fast Ags, or the drums. He really likes this mobility.
Mikasa's engaging onto Sonaco, trying to anyway, not going to work. Track out on the FY as well. This could be the site of our first major full team engagement, as both teams are spending a lot of time here. Looks like they're going to separate at least a little bit.
Sonaco's scouting everything out down bottom lane. Does give his team perhaps an opening to pressure both middle as well as the top lane there. Na'Vi side.
Ooh, bad guess on the Sunstrike. Thought he was going to catch him coming through the woods. Speaking of trying to catch somebody, Vici, under cover of smoke. Looks like they thought better of that. He may get him anyway. Sonaco, oh, there's the hand of God. Sonaco's going to be netted now and not doing the math correctly. Are they going to be able to cover him back around?
Oh, back and towards mid lane. They've found a great initiation with that smoke.
Art style. So tanky. He may get DDC. He will. Are you kidding me? The strength of the early game Enchantress just cannot be underestimated. Ends up going, giving himself up, but at least he went out with an honor guard. Blink picked up on Puck following that engagement as well. So 13 minutes in, talk to me about how you think these teams have done in terms of hitting their marks. In the meantime, we will keep an eye on Yang here at bottom.
For me, VGR's biggest mark is going to come when they get the mech on the chance. That's when they can really just take it to Na'Vi as far as going for towers. When they've got the Hand of God plus mech, the double heal, Na'Vi's teamfight initiation with the Puck Dream Call followed up by the nuke damage from Invoker as well as Puck does get somewhat negated. Even the Bouncing Shrook and a good source of AoE damage onto heroes in these fights, you need to have mech, you need to have Hand of God available. So VGR very much going to look to fight and push around the mech, and then after that, build towards the Radiance on Lone Druid. The Radiance timing is the next big scary moment for them. So if you're Na'Vi, you're thinking, try and fight away from the big five-man group up creep push of Chen. You want to try and pick your moments, find the pickups that we've seen them get using Sunstrike, using Dietra as ultimate. And I think that's something that's most impressive about Dietra as Lycan play, is he knows how and when to gank and use Shapeshift better than any other Lycan I've seen as of late.
Here's going to be FY dropping in mid, but all of Na'Vi may be jumped in return. Here they come. VGR, oh, so low. He does manage to get out of that, but no, not so lucky for Art Style Roar. For the Bounty Hunter, that is just a tremendous turnaround. Dityura will be able to metamorph, use his transformation, or shapeshift, excuse me. He's about every adjective I can think of for that. But able to use his shapeshift to get away. But that was actually brilliantly done. They gave the Chen up. I'm sure they wish he had not died quite as quickly, but he showed himself in lane just as VGR was smoking in their own secret shot.
And the cooldown, the shackle shot. Mikasa's shackle shots have been on point this game. He's actually played so impressive this game. If you showed me this game for a VGR, I would actually look at as Mikasa as being one of their star players with how well he's played this mid lane.
Storyline there, for those who are maybe just joining us, haven't watched the rest of the tournament, he's actually a stand-in. So VGR...
Yep, he's the coach.
Yeah, exactly.
Coach is being subbed in.
Yep, so...
And he's been taking on some of the world's best mid players.
He's taking on
like
Dendi
Miracle,
in Ukraine.
S4, Dendi, exactly. Like, as...
the fact that, yeah, like you said,
I think he's in a grand finals. Like, that yeah. In itself is one of the craziest things you'll ever hear.
And it should speak absolute volumes for how talented this young squad of BGR actually is.
And just, you kind of wonder, like, what could they actually do with their full roster as well here?
Right.
Moving forward, so as it stands, they are down one game against Na'Vi, but I'd say in a better position here in game number two. They've got themselves a bit of a gold lead, 2.5k net worth overall, and have a very clear game plan moving forward. When they get the mech, they get the Lone Druid Radiance, they can kind of five-man push around this. And for Na'Vi, they do not have the best deep pushing lineup. Their wave clear is limited mostly to the puck. Bounty Hunter and Enchantress, just in general, not great heroes to kind of play against that Chen push strat that you see out of teams like Alliance, and that kind of playstyle we're going to see out of VGR here as well.
Yang getting closer and closer to his Radiance, currently sitting on 3,300 gold, so the Relic will be out before long at all. But BGR happy to make plenty of space for him. They're going to go ahead and show themselves top lane. This is a 136 HP tower. Maybe they'll be able to delay this a little bit. He's got the Hellbear in position. He's going to try to clear this. Maybe try to use it. Not going to matter. I was going to say try to use it to deny it. But I don't think... Yeah, he's still probably going to give it a shot. Nope, close, but not quite.
Na'Vi have snuck their way into Roshan, seeing that BGR atop, but... Yang is nearby, we'll scout this out with the bear, and Na'Vi have already backed off, recognizing that VGR quickly got away from that top lane after taking the tower and are ready to respond to any Rosh attempts from their
side. Tell you something, not just in this series, which is one game deep, granted, but but in the entire tournament that VGR has done that is so impressive, they're a team that legitimately swarms. Like, whenever they spot something they didn't expect, whenever they see a weakness, it's not... You don't see them kind of come in a line. You don't see them come in one by one. It seems like as soon as they spot an opening, they're all five move immediately with zero hesitation, and they always move with direct intention to fight. They don't go and say, let's just play positional. If they show up and you're in the vicinity, they want to fight you, as is being displayed right now. Sineko ends up dying and giving in to mega kill streak.
And to speak to that playstyle, the player always leading the way is this guy on the gyrocopter, and is replicating his Spectre performance. He's been in 13 of the 13 kills.
13 out of 12.
But yeah, luckily the maths seem to be working today, AC. I got a good night's sleep. I've worked on my arithmetic. Things are at least adding up today.
We crunched the numbers, we did the math, and it still doesn't make sense, but that's okay. Down the bottom, they're going to engage on the Yang.
Turned
it around, gets at least one kill. He wound up dying, but now the Shackle and the Dipsy Raw! They've hauled Ty to Hound, and he's going to end up dropping and is truly unstoppable.
That's a massive turn. That's such a big win for BGR. Radiance was purchased by Lone Druid before he died. He got the kill, bought Radiance.
Spent his gold!
Didn't lose anything. And then they get two kills in return. That could not have gone worse for Na'Vi. Perhaps it's about to get a little bit better as they do find DDC. Okay, small little turnaround in their favor.
Yep.
Just a support, but a support who needs a Blink Dagger. Lion's Blink, we've seen some fantastic early game timings, but that's something VGR actually currently lack. It's the Blink Dagger on Mikasa as their main initiation tool, but having a Blink Lion to follow up with some burst damage would go a long way here as well.
Really love watching the Enchant slash Holy Persuasion wars between Chen and Enchantress, by the way. Just watching them steal each other's creeps is just so fun. And, like, I mean, we've kind of been harping on it, you know, Na'Vi's back, and, you know, before LGD was eliminated, you know, it feels like TI2. This does feel like TI2, granted, with a hell of a lot of different mechanics and all that kind of stuff, but just looking at these lineups, this is a familiar look to anyone who's been a fan of Dota for years. And
absolutely.
And it brings out... It makes me feel.
And you're back, AC. You couldn't be better.
Man, it's all perfect. Mikasa caught out here near the bounty room. And Sunstrike. I think that might be the biggest overkill ever. He got hit with Impetus. There were two other projectiles on the way and a Sunstrike.
It was just the right amount of kill because it was about to be sent back by a Chen, actually. So
good
that
call,
was about 0.1 of a second away from a send-back save, and BGR with Wind Ranger dead may actually lose Rosh control. It looks like they have positioned to fight this despite that pick off.
Roche is very low. Again, BGR swarming. They're going to use that bear, and that Radiance Burn is so intense now. And, you know, it's going to be an excellent tool if it's managed correctly to keep Dendi from using that Blink Dagger.
Na'Vi do a good job recognizing that even though they have a 5v4, they can't actually fight into the Radiance Bear too well here, and a BKB Gyrocopter. They are more than well equipped to take this Roche fight, and if Na'Vi get caught inside the pit, it's the worst possible scenario for them. So they get out, they regroup. They're going to look for a pick off here. That's kind of the nature of their lineup. They want to use the Bounty Hunter, get some vision, then set up for a good initiation for General's Puck, or something like the Shapeshift from Lycan to get things going, the Invoker to find a Sunstrike pick off. Speak of Invoker, very close to completing an Agate Scepter.
I love this. They're going to go right into Roche, and they saw General use his Blink Dagger. They know they have a few seconds here. They're going to be able to get in, and they're just going to risk it.
Yeah, Huck always spells on cooldown now, so not easy for Na'Vi to engage.
They're still going to try to come in. Here we go. Down comes the rock. It's going to be a foil. And is going to go ahead and use his BKB. Wants to focus fire down Roche. In the meantime, we're going to have the Chen dropping as well as the Puck. Aegis is picked up by Gyro, and now the chase is on. Dichirah going to drop behind the fight, as the rest of Na'Vi can do nothing but flee. They managed to get one. Power shots on point. Root? Oh no, it's so slow on the
Needed the Savage Roar, which was still on cooldown.
Well, big win for VGR, yep. And Na'Vi have got to be feeling quite worried. If you take a look at Lycan, 2-3-6. Not a very effective game out of him. And honestly, Lycan games, to me, are always characterized by this overwhelming feeling of, if we turn our back, we're going to lose objectives. If we turn our back, Lycan's going to tunnel vision and support, whatever. I have not felt like he has had a huge impact in this game thus far.
Yeah, he had a couple nice early pickoffs where he used the shapeshift, but it never really translated into key objectives.
Oh, great. Shackle onto Sameko, brought down the Maelstrom, complete on Mikasa, and showing its power. Now we're going to see this Tier 2 drop. They still got an Aegis ready to roll. Just a matter of how aggressive they want to be with it. Tier 2 mid might be the target.
Yeah, they're immediately swinging towards that direction. Artstyle needs to be a little bit careful not to get caught out here, as Mikasa, Link Shackle at the ready, but they're prioritizing objectives, and I like this from BGR. Very disciplined play. FY's joined up with his team again. The mech, the heal, is available. Doesn't have too much in the way of a creep army. In fact, it doesn't look like he's got any creep whatsoever, but it's not stopping them from pushing. They want to make use of this Aegis as well as the Spirit Bear Radiance timing.
Using the mech, keep the bear standing, following the glyph, and they're going to get the tower. Nice tip to deny there from Artstyle, but unable to get it. 24 minutes in, we've got 31 kills on the board, and we've got a lead for VGR that is rapidly growing. 7,500 gold in their favor now, just about the same number for experience.
Well, they see Dichirah.
Dichirah, this is just getting worse and worse for him.
He's down.
Oh no. 8 seconds he's got to buy, can he do it? Trying the juke. Oh, nope, Sunstrike. Will be on point. I actually thought that was going to hit them both and not do nearly as much.
He'll make it out. Okay.
Well played.
They almost
very
got some
well
kills
played.
With that Sunstrike. It looks like it was split between two heroes, otherwise would have killed off Mikasa perhaps.
You think that was split between two heroes?
I think it also hit Gyrocopter. Did you?
I know. Maybe
you're right.
No, I... Yeah, no, I... Whatever.
Well, Na'Vi looking to take the fight a bit to VGR here in the top lane. Dendi's there, ready with the Blink Aghanim Scepter. A lot of damage output potential from his combo. Something that VGR will have to respect moving forward.
Na'Vi trying to be proactive, trying to play aggressive. And I always dig it whenever a team doesn't just take a couple of losses then back. Sunako, level 9, and then they're going to go for it on Yang. This is a great pick if they can get it, and they can. That was a track kill as well. That's what Dendi needs. Not just Dendi, but Na'Vi. Literally just used Dendi and Na'Vi interchangeably.
Yeah, huge gold boost from that. Some 1,800 gold roughly with the help of the track, and VGR can't really afford to slow things down too much with that. That's a minute where Lone Druid's dead while they have Aegis. And they only had about 2 minutes left on the Aegis. So by the time Lone Druid respawns, they want to go for a push. One, they'll only have a singular bear. Two, the Aegis is about to expire. If anything, it kind of slows down a lot of the momentum and the tempo that VGR were setting. So,
Mikasa,
TP was canceled and he's now on the run.
Shackle will not last. Woo! Big swipe. from Dijira.
BGI was smoking that direction, so losing a hero before the backup arrives is a bit of a problem, but they may find Dijira regardless.
Oh no, and his shape shift is now down. This is very easy kill for them. Overextending and paying a big price for it. I was just going to say, by the way, Navi's going to run into a bit of a conundrum. Gyro has an Eagle Song, he's going Butterfly again. Should have it before long. Dijira does not have a BKB. That's something he wants, and not only wants, he absolutely needs as a necessity. There's him, and then there's, once again, Artstyle on the Enchantress, who could build an MKB. We saw with Artstyle, it came through at the end last time, but it ultimately was very problematic. It caused issues until Navi really got control of the late game.
Yeah.
Do you prioritize an MKB on Lycan, after a BKB, or do you rush it even? Or do you try to build that way with Enchantress and take the same gamble you had to in game one?
At this stage, it's an item that they just won't have an answer to for a long time. Lycan, as you said, kind of should prioritize BKB typically, but he's going to go into a solo press, it looks like. Picks up the Talisman. I like this a lot because similarly, Gyrocopter won't be able to itemize towards the MKB for some time. He wants to finish the Butterfly first. We'll be able to go MKB afterwards, but the timings are now. So for Dijira, he's thinking, what item's going to help me right away? The Bear as well as the Gyro won't have any bypass for the evasion. And the fight's going to be coming to Navi very soon. The Aegis expiring does mean they should have some time where BGI are going to look to maintain map control, but the big push is going to come with next Roshan, as well as this Butterfly on the Gyrocopter, and possibly even like the next item or two, the next singular item on the Lone Druid. Yang, sitting on 1500 gold, has a Hyperstone and AC of Lads. These types of aura teamfight items could be problematic for Navi.
Navi looking to get on the map and create problems of their own. They're five-man smoke through mid. And look at VG. Just hiding it. It's like they anticipate this.
Yeah, it's become quite a common player. Like, you smoke up as the opponent's Aegis expires. So VG are pretty much recognizing it now. They see no one farming bottom, no one farming mid, top.
Oh, now they're going to counter smoke. They're gonna counter smoke.
They know where Navi is, and they want to be the ones getting the jump.
Well, they also waited for the bear to die.
Is there gonna be a bleak shackle?
Here we go, there it is. They managed to get it off of the creep. Dindi caught with the cooldown. So they trade a bear for Dindi. I think we found Mikasa's hero, my friend.
Yeah, he's played sensationally this game. Hasn't had the best farm, but it's kind of very Alliance-esque, this draft overall. You've got the tempo controller mid Mikasa who rushed the Blink Dagger. You've got the carry offlaner in Lone Druid, and then you've got the safe lane tempo controller carry, the Gyrocopter, who just gets involved in all the fights. It's very much reminiscent of what we've seen Alliance do throughout this tournament, and some great execution coming in. They're ready to go for another push. They say, we don't actually want to wait for the next Aegis. With Dendi dead, we can actually force a buyback out of this.
The Butterfly was complete there, too.
Radiant's yep.
So
the push top is just not a big threat.
They're going to be forced to TP back. Glyph's going to be deployed. This is going to be a major deciding fight here, my friend, one way or the other.
Buyback available on Dendi, though, something that VGR will have to respect, but with 10 seconds on his respawn timer, it looks like VGR won't get too much damage onto the tier 3 tower.
Maybe that's all they wanted, was just to try and test and see if Dendi would buy back.
Absolutely. I think that's pretty much the position they were in. It also forces Navi to TP back from the top lane. Navi had three heroes top who were kind of threatening to counter push, also just farming up the Dire Jungle, so it forces Navi to make a defensive move, which is kind of not the position they want to be on. When you're a bounty hunter, you're an enchantress, you want to be active and deep on the map. You're going to be scouting out enemy heroes, being pesky, looking for couriers, disrupting the farm of VGR, but getting pulled back. But now Sonico already using this time to get himself back involved and searching for these VGR heroes.
Avicii continuing to run largely as a big five-man cadre. And wisely so, as Navi has mostly been, they're spread out now actually, but for the most part has been prioritizing the five-man approach, as you would expect with a bounty hunter. Really trying to get the most out of track. He did find his level 11 a bit ago. So level 2 track, don't know that we've really seen a huge effect out of that. Another close one, man. Beachy does maintain a lead, but it is not huge. It's about 5k, about 1k a hero in terms of overall net worth. That's one fighter. Hell, just a decent trade if there are a couple of tracks involved.
And the bad news for Navi is it's a fairly fast Roche respawn, something they're not too equipped for dealing with. The way they can contest it is going to be with the Dendi Invoker. If he can get that big combo into the Roshan pit, he's TP bottom though. He's got to make sure he doesn't get caught out here. already tucking himself into some trees. All of Na'Vi at bottom in a very precarious position.
Oh, look at DDC.
He's so close to scouting that out. He checks the little cute little hiding spot underneath those trees, but doesn't check the under the tower tree spots.
Artstyle will be shackled off of his own Alpha Wolf. That's a guaranteed kill. And now we'll see if they want to run straight to Roshan or what the plan's going to be. This option is definitely available to them. Artstyle, a huge toll.
Oh, nicely played. They catch him with the Invis TP.
So Mako.
And they've got the creep wave to push forward here at bottom. But Rosh is back. The question is the call going to be take Rosh first or go for the push? It's a guaranteed free Rosh.
Look at the respawn. I think with the respawn timers being so low on Na'Vi, that the Rosh is the call.
And much safer. Like having an Aegis on a Gyrocopter or even the Lone Druid just allows you to go for that siege in much safer fashion. AC completed as well on Lone Druid, so this Aegis could not have come at a better time. Castle will be sent home, so they're not going to just immediately transition into that bottom lane push. They're going to start pushing out this top creep wave a bit. Get everything in a position where you're not worried about Lycan in the top lane suddenly trading racks, going for like the Necro 3 backdoor type play while you go for the high ground push. That's probably like the worst case scenario for VGR. They reach high ground and they can take a lane of racks, but they're going to lose a lane themselves. So there's no rush with the Aegis pickup. They're very much stronger than Na'Vi. So just make sure that one push you go for, all of the pieces are in the right place. And that's what Mikasa's kind of setting up for in the top lane. They're going to push out mid lane. But Lycan as well as Puck both still hovering around top, knowing that they want to be there ready to counter push should VGR go for a five-man down mid or bottom.
Looks like that's what they're setting up for. Mikasa making his way there.
They're going to leave the bear top for now. That's something that Na'Vi should be looking to at least go on or pressure, but wave number one already taken out.
Getting into position, they're going to try to find somebody. You can see Ward is up here in the enemy jungle.
DTRS ulting to try to kill the Spirit Bear. I like that play. He recognizes that the Spirit Bear kills off that creep wave. He can't backdoor. That was such a smart play. Now this push top is actually coming faster than the VGR push. Forcing the Bear to use return to join up with VGR just probably saves Na'Vi's base there. If that Spirit Bear clears out the creep wave, there's no split push threat. So VGR have to fall back. They're okay with this for now. It's all about making sure that one Aegis push is successful. So they're willing to wait, settle the situation with the laning equilibrium, and then come back for another push. They're just gonna have to realize that. They're gonna have to make a concerted effort to push out this top lane even further, possibly even smoke gank their own jungle and try and find that Lycan.
Yeah, I was kind of thinking the same thing. I mean, you can see General's positioning here. He is tucked away in what would normally be considered like a Tinker or a Nature's Prophet kind of a spot. Just waiting to come in the lane as soon as he feels there's any commitment, and here he comes. Bear's gonna be there this time. Mm-hmm. And that should be enough to force it back. And that may be the go word for VGR. Yep, they're making a beeline straight to the lane.
This time the Bear not getting initiated on, so it's gonna pull the full creep wave. If this creep wave entirely dies, they're in. They're gonna go for that bottom lane push. They've just gotta kill this one last creep wave, and it looks like they'll do so without problems. Lycan very close to a BKB for this fight, 200 gold short. Oh, gonna make life a bit more difficult for them.
Lacking the BKB, such a huge deal, man.
Yep.
Here we go. In, caught with the ice wall. There's that damage. He's gotta be careful. Damage from Artstyle. There we go. There's gonna be a shackle. Does not latch this time, though.
They take a lot of damage there to start things off, but the Bear's already hitting the T3 tower, forcing a glitch.
Oh, here we go. Coldell's gonna be there, but they get the Gyros. Aegis with a well-placed Sunstrike. Aegis up, there's going to be the people right on top of him. DDC actually not the low ground, but a beautiful Ravage. Shackle! Double kill for Mikasa!
Three men impale.
So gorgeous.
And now, full initiations from DDC.
He just cut in your own General. He almost could have finished General off with a power shot. And Dendi trying to make him pay as much as they can. They already got the Rax. Mikasa's big cold snap. And will end up dropping to it, but Na'Vi again. Losing the racks, they're gonna get the bear too. This is a pretty nice catch. Maybe. Are they actually
not easy
it?
To kill the bear. Very fast. Let's get FY instead. Yep. Alright, that's probably better than the bear. Oh my god, he gets puck in return?
That's
FY.
Ridiculous.
That's an FY play if I've ever seen one. Okay. General's going to be kicking himself a bit for that one.
I was going to say, is that so much an FY play? And don't get me wrong, he makes a lot of amazing plays, or is that a misplay from General?
It's a misplay from General, but most Chens there would just, like, go down without a fight. Radiant's very few Chens would just have to know how to, like, turn around and kill off the puck there.
MKB now up on the gyrocopter. His damage is getting terrifying. S and Y butterfly.
And now they've got the answer to the solar crest as well.
Oh, that's a great
point,
yeah.
This Lycan gets a lot squishier. Also, doesn't have to worry about the solar crest being applied onto himself for the mischance. Won't be an Aegis for the next push, I believe. Ooh, Blade Mail Spirit Bear.
That's fun.
Does hurt Dendi a lot, because he's often throwing his combo onto that Spirit Bear. Same thing for the Enchantress, who is just chunking the Spirit Bear with the Impetus. And neither of these players with BKB. We'll see again the Demon Edge MKB build coming out from the outstyle Enchantress. Wants to have an answer for the frontlining Gyrocopter, as well as the Radiance, which also applies a mischance onto him.
At this point, I feel like VGR is just about, I mean, they've got pretty much every item they really, really want to go fight. For
apart
not
from the Chen-Ags. Chen-Ags is a big deal call. Because you get the Magic Immune Black Dragon in the front lines, the Granite Golem, which gives you a big boost in HP. That's something which Na'Vi's side will actually really struggle to deal with.
Well, he's not far from it. In fact, he's got it, like, pretty much now. Yep. Like, if he wanted to sell his TP, he'd have it right this second.
I need the 250 more, 1200 for the point boost.
Oh,
but he'll get
sorry.
There.
For some reason I saw the Ogre Club and for, I guess the excitement getting to me a little bit, but yes, you're right.
FY is going to look to keep the creepy equilibrium out in the bottom lane. They don't need to get this Ranger exit bottom lane, so they're kind of just sitting grouped. They're making sure they're not going to get caught up by Na'Vi smoke or anything by staying grouped together as much as possible. Also just maintaining map control by taking over Na'Vi's farm in their own jungle, so limiting the access points for Na'Vi in terms of catch-up gold available to them.
Overall net worth, the gyro is on top. Dendi did just complete a BKB, so looking to be a little bit more survival. There's the MKB out of art style, second game in a row for an art style MKB Enchantress. They do have the tools to bring down... Once again, caught out, he's gonna be hexed. Shackles on point, call down just to make a point.
No, he canceled the TP.
Probably the right call.
Zaniko nearby, they had a couple there. If that was like a two-man gank, then he probably completes his TP and tries to turn that one around, but VGR, it's never a two-man gank. There's always three, four, five. You talked about their playstyle, how they love to just swarm on you. Make sure they always bring everyone, as more so at this crucial stage of the game. You're 38 minutes in. We'll see what Na'Vi have up their sleeve to try and turn this one around. Oh. They did it in game one.
Dendi gets eyes on FY. This one they got up their sleeve. General there to jump in with him. Using the Greaves, buys himself a little time, and the Hand of God. Just trying to buy time. He's going to turn and do work. The Sunstrike actually misses, and now he's going to be used. The Baron is there. They're going to eventually get him, but let's see if there's going to be any reprisal. They wasted a lot of Na'Vi's time there. And yeah, it gave him just enough time because he's right on top of Sineko. May not realize it yet. Now he's going to be spotting Dendi. DDC is there. Two-man coil. Big disaster for BG. As now Na'Vi engaging, but End is there to bring it in to Dendi.
Yeah, End doing a lot of damage, as well as the Spirit Bear with the Yang Lone Druid. It got on top of Dendi as well, and taking out the Invoker takes away the majority of that Na'Vi damage up, but he wasn't able to get... Not sure if he just picked up his BKB now, didn't use it in that fight, and...
No, he had it. He had it.
It doesn't help against the Lone Druid, which I believe was all the damage that pretty much killed him off. Yeah, looking at the damage done, it was all the Lone Druid and Gyrocopter. The Lone Druid, once that bears on top of Dendi's Invoker, he doesn't have something like a 4-star to get him away, and he finds himself in a lot of trouble.
This is actually a huge deal, man. Dendi doesn't have buyback.
Yeah. It may just be a Rax. With the Blade Mail on Bear, no one wants to attack him for that short duration. It's got such a short cooldown as well.
He's down for 45 more seconds. It may be more than one Rax.
Yep. They get the full mid lane. They send the Bear bottom, probably just looking to get the gold from the range Rax. And Na'Vi find themselves at a huge deficit here in game number two.
It's going to be their call down to try and clean house. And Chen's creeps there. Actually gets sent back as well. So really well played by Vici. And in the blink of an eye, what was a successful gank, kited out by FY, bought enough time for his team to get in position. and they manage to catch Dindi with his pants down a bit, not enough gold to buy back after his death, and they're down two racks now.
And it's about to get a whole lot harder. Roche respawning very soon. Ends pretty much reach his peak. He's six slotted for the most part. He can upgrade to a Boots of Travel. There's better items than an SMY in the late game, but he's got everything he needs to just end this game with an Aegis on his team.
So,
Roche going to be the final straw for Na'Vi, who recognize that and want to contest it. They've smoked up a couple here. DDC, he's in this. He actually pops the smoke and there's no detection there for it. Roche already down.
Aegis picked up by the Wind Ranger this time. DDC has a lot of health on the way. That's actually going to be a beautiful tornado and a rock. Dodge by DDC at the very least. Now we're going to try to chase him down. Mikasa, right on Arslan. He's so low. Hand of God is there. And they managed to bring him down before Mikasa. And now next is going to be in securing another kill. That time onto the bounty. And at this point, do believe we're reaching the end of this game.
Mikasa has a cheese available to him, so he's going to heal up. Has full HP and mana now for this. Has that second life. Na'Vi with no buybacks, it looks like that fight there was the nail in the coffin.
I mean, I was checking the charts before that fight happened. I think the coffin was already closed, if not entirely covered up in dirt, quite some time ago. But Na'Vi continues to put forth the big fight, didn't you, Raw? And just melting like a support at this point, dies at the foot of his own fountain. And that's going to be GG. And just like that, after a truly grueling victory for Na'Vi in game one. Peachy manages to counter punch and draw a little blood themselves. All knotted up 1-1 now. And just like that, David, our best of five becomes a best of three.
It's all smiles from BGR.
Yep.
End on the gyrocopter has got to be patting himself on the back or get his teammates to do it because he was everywhere, involved in all the